right, then has a very serious issue that he needs to address on behalf of our members. And so he sends his apologies, of course, and I do bring our solidarity. Solidarity Unite, our executive, and of course from Len. And before I start, I just want to congratulate the Institute of Employment Rights and CAD, and thanks very much for chairing tonight's proceedings. Also want to thank the Campaign for Trade Union Freedoms for all the work that's being done on behalf of the wider trade union movement in the fight for wider trade union freedoms. But of course I want to thank all of those, and some of them have spoken tonight, particularly the students, UK Uncut, Occupy, the firefighters, the teachers, the railway workers, those health workers, all of those workers that right now are standing up, not just against austerity, but on behalf of their members, with their members in the fight for justice within our society. And of course, I want to also thank the People's Assembly, and Sam spoke on behalf of the People's Assembly, but I'm very proud, and Unite's very proud, to hold the chair of the People's Assembly and the fantastic work that we do there. Of course, the People's Assembly was born out of a political necessity to put an umbrella over the fight against austerity. To unite in actions, and these are our actions as well, those unions, campaign groups, politicians, community activists fighting against the obscenity of austerity and the ideological attack that's being waged right now against working class communities across our nations. And the fight for trade union freedoms, the fight to protest, to organise, to mobilise for mass disobedience, is a fight for social progress. It's a fundamental human right. It's about fundamental freedoms. It's a fight for a better and for a fairer society. Our history, colleagues, is a history of protest and civil disobedience with direct action. When we look at our history, we can go back to the Chartists, to the suffragettes, to the poll tax riots, to stop the war. 2 million people on the street in the stop the war protest. From the student protests, and I always salute those students in 2010 that were on the streets taking direct action and fighting back, while we as a trade union movement were sitting around at the TUC discussing the minutes of the last meeting. From the abolition of child labour and the fight against fascism to the creation of the welfare state and our NHS. From the free education for all fight to the fight for equal pay and the living wage. From dignity in retirement to maternity and paternity rights. Our history, the history of the working class, is a history of class struggle. And for 30 years our rights have been under attack. Attacks disgracefully left unchallenged despite 13 years of a Labour administration. And of course the legacy of Thatcher lives on. It lives on in Cameron and his Eton boys. Now we want to move on to renew the attack on organised labour. To remove the fight to organise, to bargain collectively. And we've listened to John over many, many years and we're fundamentally behind the fight for collective bargaining. To peacefully protest. And of course the fundamental human right to withdraw your labour, the right to strike. Whether it's the lobbying bill or the gagging bill, as it's more commonly referred to, state-sponsored theft of union membership information, an outrageous attack on individual privacy. Whether it's attempting to silence the collective political voice of trade unions. Whether it's about leaving employers free to challenge union data, to undermine democratic mandates for strike action. Or the call for minimum turnouts and even the banning of strikes. The banning of strikes was called for just last week in response to the London Underground dispute. And this buffoon Boris Johnson, who sits there calling for 50%, and it's already been noted already this evening. A man elected on a ballot of just 38% turnout and only 17% of the vote, has the audacity to challenge, we will take no lessons from Johnson, Cameron, or any of those comrades, we already face the most restrictive legislation, anti-union legislation, in the Western world. And that was not a point that was lost, of course, on Tony Blair, who was quite proud to announce that we were the most restrictive Labour legislative regime in the Western world. And still further, Cameron's announced this inquiry into protests, intimidation and harassment following lawful protests in support of our members at Grangemouth. And of course, this is headed up by Bruce Carr, and we're no stranger to Bruce Carr. I personally appeared in the High Court and was questioned by Bruce Carr, who on two occasions represented British Airways in our fight for justice and fairness for BA cabin crew. And on two occasions, he succeeded in stopping industrial action by injunction, but of course failing to prevent it ultimately when our members won through and took fantastic action that won a fantastic victory there at British Airways. But there are no side members now. No side members on this inquiry, this panel, this investigation that Cameron's introduced. Nothing but a partisan attack and a springboard for still further anti-union legislation and anti-protest legislation to come. So harassment and intimidation is the name of the game. Well, I'll tell you what's harassment and intimidation. Threatening to close a plant and sack 900 workers. That's intimidation and harassment. Giving hard-working people 48 hours to sign up to reduce pay, to the end of a pension scheme, to their entitlement to union rights. Posting DVDs through letterboxes so that the conflict is taken to your family, so you have to have the discussion with your kids about the impact of a dispute. Forcing out a proud trade unionist from a plant that he'd worked in for 26 years and sacking our convener at Grangemouth. That's intimidation. And that was done by an individual that owns that plant, a plant responsible for 12% of Scottish GDP on its own. A single plant responsible for 12% of Scottish GDP. An individual that led that dispute in the fight against our members and my union from the luxury of a £125 million yacht moored in the Mediterranean. That is criminal, comrades. And if people think that they can make decisions to sack our people, cut our wages, take away our pensions, and then slope off into obscurity, they can think again. Because I've got a message for Cameron. You can pass any legislation you want. You can put us outside the law if you want. But if you put us outside the law, we'll operate outside the law.
But the share of GDP that's gone to working people
has dropped from 65% to 53%. And the difference there is trousers and lining the pockets of the very rich, of course. At the same time, the number of workers covered by collective agreements, and John makes this point very eloquently, has dropped from 82% to 22%. This is the longest decline in living standards since the 1870s, and Queen Victoria was on the throne. There was an Oxfam report came out to coincide with the first day of the Davos meeting. And this is very interesting. 85 people, the richest 85 people, and you could get them on a double-decker bus, the richest 85 people on this planet have more wealth than the combined wealth of the poorest 50% on this planet. Just think about that for a minute. The richest 85 people have a bigger combined wealth than the poorest 50%. And an earlier study by Oxfam, because there's some good stuff at Oxfam, identified that the earnings, not the wealth, the earnings of the richest 100 on this planet in 2012 alone could have eradicated extreme poverty on our planet. The earnings of the richest 100 people in 1 year. In 1 year. That's obscene. Now that's our challenge, colleagues. That's our challenge. To fight self-defeat and austerity with a bold and a radical programme. To put our people back to work, to grow our economy, to give hope to our young and dignity to our elderly. To protect our NHS, our welfare state and our public services. To bring back under public control our railways, our energy companies, our post office and our utilities. To fight as our fathers and our mothers and our grandparents have fought. To stand up in those who can and for those that come. To stand up for a better Britain, a fairer Britain, a socialist Britain. Solidarity, comrades.